Hi everyone, I'm Mark, a GMAT instructor with Manhattan Prep, and I'm here today with an expert level problem for you to try, if you dare. Pause the video for 2 minutes, give this a try, and then we will work it through. You're back. You didn't run away. Okay, so we have survived this particular problem. Just so you know, this is the kind of problem that you can miss all day long and still get an excellent score on the GMAT. But what I love about this is it still gets back to some fundamental concepts that we're going to need at all levels on this test. Let's start with the question of what actually makes this an expert level problem. When you glance at it, it doesn't look that intimidating at first, but it's important to note that our initial perception of difficulty is not going to perfectly align with how the test rates difficulty. The test rates difficulty according to just who got the problem right and who got it wrong when it was an experimental problem. So a hard problem is one that even very high-level test takers still missed at a higher rate. And this one has a couple features that cause some of those misses. One of them I want to point out right away is this concept of layering. What is this problem about? What's the content being tested here? Well, statistics for sure. We got a couple different statistical measures in the mean or the average. We don't need to be fancy. We'll just call it the average. And the median. So I've got a word problems type in statistics. But then as I look at the statements, I've got inequalities. That's an algebra topic. So the test writers have layered together a couple different content areas. It's one of their go-to ways to make a problem a little bit harder. The other thing I want you to notice here is that most of the work is going to be in the question stem. Look how much more complicated that stem is than the statements themselves. So if we can do a good job in the stem, we're setting ourselves up for success in those statements. So let's break this down. Another interesting thing about these two particular topics that have been layered together is I have kind of a go-to approach for both of these. I want to visualize things on a number line. And I want to do that with inequalities, and I want to do that with statistics. With inequalities, when I visualize on a number line, now the inequality just becomes directional. Greater than means to the right, less than means to the left. It's a little easier to keep track of things. And oftentimes in statistics, if we can just visualize our data set, that's going to unlock some important things for us in the problem. So I'm going to begin here by just sketching out a number line and placing in what I know. So I know in my set, I've got a -2. All right, so I'll indicate a point right there. I've got a +4. And I've got this number n. I don't know where this is. So I'll just kind of sketch off to the side so I don't forget. N is somewhere here in the picture. What is the actual question asking? Is the average greater than the median? Let me jot that down so I don't lose sight of what I'm looking for. Is the average greater than the median? I'll label this as being the question. Circle it so I can reference it anytime I want. And I'll jot down a little yes, no to remind myself I'm not looking for a specific value here. I'm looking to answer this yes or no question. So what's interesting about this picture? Well, n right now could be anywhere, but I can see as it relates to the average and the median, there's kind of one really interesting place to put it. That would be right in the middle between these two given values. If I put n right here at 1, think about what will happen with the average and the median. So this becomes an evenly spaced set, meaning that at this point, 1, the average is actually equal to the median. All right, so that's kind of interesting. Basically, they equate right there, so things might be changing in terms of which one is bigger if I were to shift to the left or shift to the right. All right, what else do I want to consider? Well, little data sufficiency pro tip here. I don't want to use the statements just yet because I'm still analyzing the question stem, but I can absolutely take a peek at them and see what's going to be interesting in this problem. So I can see from taking a peek at the statements that I might have a little interest in 2 and 3 in particular, kind of what's happening over in this region, a little to the right of the midway point. So let's think this through together. If I were to sketch a big point for n right there at 1, so at that point, the average is equal to the median. But if I were to shift this up just a little bit, so take this point and push it up into this 2 to 3 region, well, the median is going to track exactly with n. It's still the middle number. So however much I push n up by, the median is going to go up by the same amount. the average will also go up, but not by as much, because when I total up these numbers, I have to divide by 3. So for example, if I push n up by 1, the median goes up by 1, but the average only goes up by 1/3. And what this argument demonstrates is that in that region at least, that sort of 2 to 3 that is of interest to us, the answer to the question in that region is going to be no. The average will be smaller than the median. All right. Now I can figure out even more here and actually plot out where the answer is yes, where the answer is no on the full number line. That seems a bit like overkill. I think I've figured out the pieces of this that I'm really going to need for this problem. So now I will jump into the statements. Statement 1, n is greater than 2. So I'm suspicious of this because there's no upper boundary, but let me prove that this is not sufficient. So if, for example, n is 2.5, that's right in the middle of that no region we identified already. So the question now is, can I get a yes? Is that possible? Well, yeah, there's no upper boundary, so I could just do something ridiculous, like make n 1,000, right? So that's going to pull the average way up, but the median is going to be stuck down at 4, which would be the middle number there. So that is not sufficient. How about 2 on its own? N is less than 3. Again, I've got the easy case where n is just 2.5, right in the middle of that no region. So all I have to do here is convince myself that I could get a yes as well. Well, we talked about starting n at 1 and pushing it up a little. Imagine going the other direction, pulling it down. That's going to pull the median down by however much we pull n down by, but it's only going to pull the average down by 1/3 of that because we're just changing one of the 3 numbers. So if I were to push it down to, say, 0, that would be firmly in yes territory. So this is also not sufficient. We are down in our data sufficiency grid at this point to C and E. So it's time to put them together. And the work is already done for us. Together, we're right in that green territory. We know that's going to be a no to this question, so sufficient. All right. A little more than we maybe bargained for when we first glanced at it, right? And that can happen for sure. But some really important takeaways here. Visualization for these content areas, statistics and inequalities, a very useful tool. And data sufficiency fundamentals. We ended up using some fundamental techniques like testing cases here to get to that one. So don't forget, even as you go to these higher levels, really having the basics mastered continues to be very important. Make a plan to come back to this one later to see if you can do it fully on your own. Subscribe for more GMAT Math Spotlight videos from Manhattan Prep and leave us a comment telling us how you solved this problem. Happy studying.